Welcome to The Debate, a regular series produced by UNICEF's Office of Research, where key issues affecting the world's children are discussed by global experts. Today we will ask, will there ever be an AIDS-free generation? Joining me today in our Washington studio are Joy Phumaphi, former Minister of Health in Botswana and a member of the Global Leaders Council for Reproductive Health. Also with us is Geeta Rao Gupta, Deputy Executive Director of the UN Children's Fund, and Dr. John Santelli, President for the Society for Adolescent Health and Medicine and Professor at Columbia University. Finally, Attapon Ed Ngoksin from the International Treatment Preparedness Coalition. Joy, I thought we could start with you. At least half of all new HIV infections in the developing world are amongst youth and young adults. What is happening at that key stage of life?
I think one thing we have to appreciate about where developing countries are, particularly those developing countries that are at the epicenter of the epidemic, in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa specifically, are that these countries are experiencing a huge youth bulge. Enormous. 65% of the population in these countries is under the age of 35. And 35% of the population is between the ages of 15 and 35 years. We're talking about young people. They're at an age when they're discovering their bodies, when they're experiencing sexuality, and of course, they will experiment. But the important thing, the important question is, what are we doing in order to arm them with the information, with the knowledge, with the skills that will enable them to protect themselves?
Geeta, what is your perspective on this?
I think that, those are two of the reasons why adolescents are infected in such large numbers. But I think the other part that we need to take some responsibility for is that the way in which we provide the information and the interventions for HIV prevention don't necessarily match adolescents' needs and perspectives. I mean, we have not succeeded to the extent that we should have by now to provide adolescent-friendly services, to provide the information in a way that's attractive to adolescents, that makes sense in the context of adolescents' lives. So I think there's a way that we need to adapt and understand adolescents' realities better in order to ensure that the interventions that we know have an impact are in fact accessible to them and used by them.
30 years into this epidemic, we've really learned a lot about, you know, where the epidemic is, you know, what causes the epidemic, why youth are at risk, but we've also learned a lot about prevention.
And how can one move ahead, thinking about programs for adolescent girls in particular, within a context of gender inequality, of violence against women and girls?
So we've known for a while that, you know, societal factors like gender inequality stand in the way of the success of interventions that we know work. For girls, particularly adolescent girls, it's a particular problem because they stand at the intersection of two structural inequalities, fundamental structural inequalities in society, gender and age. So a younger person has less power in society than an older person, and girls and women have less power than men and boys. And I think that for adolescent girls, then that's like a double jeopardy. And so in order for them to be able to access and use the services that are available to them, we have to address the underlying inequality. And that then broadens the response beyond just this, the high-impact HIV prevention interventions. So in order to make those prevention interventions truly effective, we have to think of things like keeping girls in school up beyond primary into secondary, because that's the stage at which adolescent girls often drop out. Making sure that girls don't get married young, for in many countries there are, you know, in some countries like in South Asia, the statistic is almost half the girls who are below the age of 18 are married. So when they get married that young and have children, which automatically follows very young, the trajectory of their lives shifts in a direction that is very difficult to reverse. And when they are married to men who are much older and more sexually experienced, the possibility of risk and exposure to HIV is higher. In that kind of a dynamic, the power imbalance is so significant, where so they can't negotiate their own safety. They find it difficult to leave a relationship that is risky, yeah, because they are dependent on the man then. Mm-hmm. They fear abandonment. They're more vulnerable to violence. Mm-hmm. They are now, because they drop out of school to get married, they're less likely to have economic opportunities. Mm-hmm. So all of those structural factors that that sort of are embedded in that inequality contribute to their vulnerability, which contributes to their, yeah, risk, mm-hmm, of HIV. Mm-hmm. And so unless we deal with those structural factors that contribute to vulnerability, mm-hmm, it's very difficult for them, mm-hmm, to be able to access and use, mm-hmm, the prevention interventions that work.
Joy, I want to ask you, what is your perspective on the issue of gender inequality and violence against women and girls?
I would say the situation is very, very similar. Mm-hmm. You know, in our part of the world, you find that the major crime that is reported against against a young people, particularly young women, mm-hmm, is that of rape. Mm-hmm. And you find that most of the rapes are of young people. Mm-hmm. That is where most of the violent rapes occur. And you will also find that the legal framework in these countries is very, very underdeveloped and is not able to effectively protect the young people in the manner, mm-hmm, in which it can. So we have to first start with the laws and the legislation,
yeah,
and make sure that once you have a proper legal framework in place, then you have the structures, mm-hmm, that are going to ensure that you enforce the, mm-hmm, laws in the right manner. And this is another area which you find is very, very, very weak. Mm-hmm. You know, there are very, very weak child protection services, very, very weak social service structures that are going to ensure that, mm-hmm, these children are supported in the right manner. And also that you do have effective education and, you know, socialization programs that are going to address the males, mm-hmm, the young people, and sometimes the, mm-hmm, adults who are responsible for the violent rape.
Yeah. Ed, yes. What do you think?
Well, I just want to add on the structural challenges that what young people have been saying and they, mm-hmm, continue to say is really the access to services, be it treatment, prevention, care, and support. But because maybe many countries, particularly in my regions, really prohibit young people to access without, mm-hmm, parental consent or the guardian consent, mm-hmm, and that's really represent a big challenge in my regions, because many young people, including adolescents, at a very young age, they already seek services, mm-hmm, and if they are not able to receive services that they seek, mm-hmm, then I think that's even drive them underground and really, mm-hmm, put them at risk of HIV infection. Mm-hmm. And in terms of males and boys' engagement, I definitely agree with what has been said, because the violence that we see today, be it against men as well, against women, is a result of violence that these men experience when growing up. Mm-hmm. And the role model is something that we need to promote, and the engagement of them in the programs to address, mm-hmm, the harmful laws or cultural beliefs, like the corrective rape in South Africa or some other, mm, harmful, like early or forced marriage.
Botswana had universal access to education even at the, mm-hmm, time when the epidemic hit. Mm. And it was not just universal access to primary education, but also universal access to secondary education. Mm-hmm. So people were being educated, but I think the question is, what were they being educated on? Oh. And the extent to which the education was actually relevant to arming them, mm-hmm, with the information and the knowledge and the skills that would enable, mm-hmm, them to fight the epidemic. Mm-hmm. And this is where we made a mistake. We did not have a robust sexual education program, mm-hmm, that would be able to arm people to combat, mm-hmm, this epidemic. So whereas education is important, what you are being taught and, mm-hmm, how you are being taught, mm-hmm, it, and the extent to which you it relates to your particular environment, mm-hmm, is extremely important.
I want us to turn our attention for the time being to specific group of adolescents. Adolescents who inject drugs, adolescent males who have sex with other males, and adolescents in sex work. I think we would all concur that there are significant challenges. What are some of the things you think we could have done different, and some of the things we still can do different to make a real impact at those young people who are at particular risk, I think, in any country in the world?
I think we should start talking about it, because in a normal education setting, the comprehensive sexual education is not there. Identifying yourself as men who have sex with men find it really difficult to understand the environment they are in, and issue around self-acceptance when you are taught in a very with the curriculum that really tells you that it's only sexual health for male and female.
Yeah.
And that's, I think it's really critical, and the resources haven't been really focusing on supporting these very groups, the young men who have sex with men, young sex worker, young drug users. So I think moving forward, there's a clear consensus that these particular groups need to be paid particular attention, and there's a lot of community-based organization or initiative are trying their best to really reach out to this very group, because they often do not come forward to receive services because of stigma and discrimination. Some of the group are also being criminalized. And I think it's really important that these services that really able to reach them continue to be provided and also continue in a more sustainable way because of funding situation in a time when we have a crisis.
The kinds of programs he's just described for these specific populations and the kinds of approaches we need to take, would that be applicable to youth in the general population?
Well, I mean, the principle that he talked about was to try and fight social marginalization and the discrimination and stigma that's associated with it, because that's what ultimately fuels the epidemic. It's the fact that it's them and us, you know, and that they're the bad ones, we're the good ones. It's those dichotomies in society that that create the problem.
Is there a willingness to overcome this kind of prejudice and fear that that we've spoken about?
Well, the cost of not overcoming it is very high. We lose our young in their most productive years. That's a huge cost for any society. So I think that, you know, the cost of inaction is so high that I don't think we've talked about that enough. You know, with adolescents, if you don't deal with the psychosocial needs of, you know, positive adolescents, you know, what does that mean for the economy of the country?
John, what do you think?
No, I absolutely agree with that. I think stigma is an essential piece of this mixture. That, you know, we know epidemiologically certain groups, certain behaviors put you more at risk. So, but how we treat those people and how we provide services to young people who are gay or bisexual or questioning is essential. And we there's good evidence, for instance, where you reduce stigma, health improves. You know, mental health improves and HIV risk improves. So I think that's an essential component, and it's part of the power dynamics. Women literally are stigmatized in certain societies. Drug users are stigmatized. So anytime you push a group to the margins, it's harder to do education, it's harder to do risk reduction, it's harder to provide services.
So let me
and
ask
that,
you,
and that is what
Joy,
we
yes.
need to learn in Africa, because I mean in Africa we still have a huge challenge in terms of you know, sexual minorities, a tremendous challenge, and the people have become so marginalized and so ostracized from the rest of society, and so scared, you know, of coming out of the closet that they operate, you know, right on the fringes of society and even, you know, below below the radar, so they're totally inaccessible. Impossible to program for because they are they are totally marginalized. But I think this same lesson applies to in some of the marginalized indigenous groups in our countries, and these are traditionally the indigenous groups in our communities. So you are finding that the incidence of HIV/AIDS in the amongst those groups is actually much higher than in the rest of the population. And for precisely the same reasons that you gave because they are now experiencing double jeopardy. They were discriminated against, stigmatized. Now the with the HIV AIDS stigma, it becomes even worse.
I think the we've talked a lot about what should be done, so it seems not new because we've talked about it for so long. But we haven't acted upon it. So, you know, we've acted upon some, but not all. So I don't think, I think we get a B plus, not an A. Certainly not an A plus, but we don't get a C. You know, we're as an AIDS community, I think We've been pretty comprehensive in the way we've looked at the problem,
yeah.
the way we've analyzed it, the mm-hmm. evidence we've sought.
Yeah.
It's the application of mm-hmm. it comprehensively in a targeted way for those who need it most that we haven't been the best at. And the reason that that's not happened mm-hmm. is political barriers mm-hmm. and social barriers.
Yeah.
You know, we talked a minute ago about community engagement, Joy said was important.
Mm-hmm.
It's important because it's adults who stand in the way of adolescents mm-hmm. getting free and frank information about sex.
Yep.
Because we have these misconceived notions mm-hmm. about you know, if we give them the information, they'll be more promiscuous, or mm-hmm. Somehow marriage will protect them, and so get them married, even if you have to get them married at a young age, somehow
yeah.
that'll be protective. Evidence shows that's not true, but
yeah.
for societal attitudes about those mm-hmm. things to change over time is going to mm-hmm. take a while.
Yeah.
We've learned a lot more about how to leverage that kind of change through, you know, social protection programs, cash mm-hmm. transfers, what incentives can work.
There's yes. a full-scale, targeted, low cost but not compromising quality implementation. Ed, from your perspective, what's one other thing you think we need to do different? And then Joy, maybe you can share with us your perspective.
I think we need to recognize the work that a lot of youth-led initiative does to reach
okay.
out in terms of the comprehensive sexual education.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really important to try to find the answers of what put all these young people at risk, particularly
mm-hmm.
those young key affected populations, and what kind of services they need, for example, because a group of young key affected populations or young people are really diverse, and young people who use drugs, for example, they do need specific services for themselves, like harm reduction services and also access to, you know, a different range
mm-hmm.
of services, and young men who have sex with men who also have a specific need in terms of the STI
yeah.
and testing and counseling.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we need to understand better what kind of services that is
mm-hmm.
Needed, and how would you provide that services in the context that is friendly, that they could access. The other problem that I think is really difficult to address is also the needs of young people who young adolescents living with HIV who are
yeah.
born with HIV.
Mm-hmm.
There's a whole bunch of issues that
mm-hmm.
we don't have information about.
Yeah.
For example, the influence of HIV treatment on the cognitive and psychological kind of aspect
mm-hmm.
of the person, and or how would you provide the continuum of care that really
mm-hmm.
taking care of their livelihood from transitioning from pediatric to adult treatment.
Mm-hmm. I think we're at a totally different place now from where we were 10 or even 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
5 years ago, we knew that the epidemic was young, and we
mm-hmm.
knew that it had a face of a woman, a female face. But we also thought that behavioral change was difficult, was not going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the youth are showing us the way in terms of behavioral change.
Mm-hmm.
The success stories now in sub-Saharan Africa in terms of reducing transmission levels is amongst the young people. There
mm-hmm.
are countries that have experienced 30% or more reduction in transmission levels amongst young people. And this shows us that when young people are targeted with the right type of programming, behavioral change does happen
mm-hmm.
and the reduction in infection levels is going to occur.
We don't have enough of it right now. All the psychosocial support services that you need to be integrated within treatment
mm-hmm.
and within prevention, that's not happening yet for young people. Because the reality of having a whole cohort of adolescents living with HIV is fairly new, who are on
mm-hmm.
treatment
yeah.
and can lead
mm-hmm.
productive long lives.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
also like the issue around the use of suboptimal treatment regimens, that
mm.
if you put the kids on the D4T, then you could see the side effects of it. And
mm.
when you're young, you really care about how
you
look.
How
and
you
then
look.
If you have a side effect,
and
that really
your
tells.
Your body is still developing. So again, there's
yeah.
almost that
mm.
double.
Definitely. So
double
the issue
negative.
Around treatment and access to treatment,
mm-hmm.
I think, come into play
mm-hmm.
really a lot in the context
yeah.
of young
mm-hmm.
people living with HIV.
So, Joy, what are the prospects for an AIDS-free generation?
Like I said earlier, my feeling is that we have witnessed the most success in the fight against HIV/AIDS amongst young people. And I feel that if we focus our attention amongst the young people, then we do stand a good chance of turning mm-hmm. the tap off. Because the issue is turning the tap off on new infections. That is really how you're going to get yeah. an HIV/AIDS-free generation. And we do have a very, very, I think, critical arsenal now of interventions mm-hmm. and that we know work and that have, you know, been proven to actually work mm-hmm. that can get us there.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't deny that there is still a lot more that can be done, a lot more research that can be mm-hmm. done. We haven't done enough on pediatric HIV/AIDS, for example, mm-hmm. in order to guarantee people who are born with HIV/AIDS a better quality life when they become adolescents.
Yeah.
We need to do a lot more work in those areas in order yeah. to ensure that you know, children get the same quality of treatment as adults.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's a huge abomination mm-hmm. and a serious indictment on the on us as a civilization that we are putting mm-hmm. adults mm-hmm. Prioritizing adults over children.
Yeah.
But I definitely do believe that we focus on the young people, we respond in the way that we know works, we will get an HIV-free generation.
I want to ask a devil's advocate question. Joy yeah. seems very optimistic. What do you think? Do you think we can get there?
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. We can eliminate perinatal transmission. Mm-hmm. We know how to do it. We know a lot about, with targeted interventions, with structural interventions, how to prevent youth mm-hmm. from getting infected. And finally, we know how to treat people.
Yeah.
And the treatment is getting cheaper, but we know how to treat people. And if we can get the majority, the most of the people who are positive into treatment, it's a great prevention tool. It's now a question of political will. Yeah. Are we going to do it?
And maybe some resources. Ed, what do you think?
Well,
would young people agree?
I think young people would agree with cautious, mm-hmm. because I think there's a lot of challenges that we need to address. For example, the prevention of mother to child, vertical transmission. A lot of countries still use a single dose nevirapine, which yeah. is not 100% effective mm-hmm. in preventing infection. And that problem being associated with the cost of treatment as well, that the national government decides that they should provide prevention method that is most affordable. And it's the same issues with the treatment that young people are receiving now. So I think there's many challenges when we talk about access to care and treatment and support, mm-hmm. and particularly in the climate where the trade-related barriers could block access to generic mm-hmm. medicines, I think that needs to be really looked at really seriously, because that would damage mm-hmm. the success that yeah. we have done this far. Mm-hmm. So I think addressing the needs of young people is important, but also on the front, it has to be addressed as well mm-hmm. comprehensively, so that we make sure that whoever needs treatment get it and get in quickly yeah. and retain in care. And those who need the services most, which is a young key affected population, young men who have sex with men, young drug user, young sex worker, could receive service
yeah.
without prejudice and could access and retain in care once they are identified as HIV mm-hmm. positive.
Geeta, how soon? How soon can we get there?
Well, I think it's within our grasp. It definitely is. I'm optimistic about that. But it does need targeted, focused efforts now.
Mm-hmm.
And it will need resources for that last mile. So we can't give up. You know, it's somebody called it the final sprint.
Yeah.
In a marathon. And we need to really focus on what we know works in the places where it's most needed, with the people who need it the most.
Mm-hmm.
We need to make sure that we are sort of gathering the evidence as we go along so that we can replicate quickly.
Mm-hmm.
We need to scale up. But for all of that, countries, governments need to have plans where they know what is driving their epidemic in their context
mm-hmm.
and apply the resources in a targeted way to those yeah. areas.
Yeah, yes. Despite the economic financial challenges that
yeah.
we have all faced as a global community, so the returns are obvious.
Yeah.
We have to continue to sustain the mm. investment. Mm.
Everybody, thank you mm. so much.
Yeah.
I'm afraid that's all we have time for. I'm sure you'll agree that it's been a compelling discussion, to say the least. I would like to thank all of our panelists and participants for their contributions today. And thank you very much for watching the debate.